2 Corinthians 6:14. I will read this scripture again so that we have an idea of what we're talking about. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? What communion hath light with darkness? What concord hath Christ with Belial? Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? Ye are the temple of the living God, as God hath said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord. And touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. And will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Father, we would ask that you would help us to continue this study this afternoon. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We've been studying Christian life, and we gave you an outline. We're some way down the outline, and we start on Article 3, separate from false religion. Separate from false religion. And the part of that scripture that I want to apply is, what accord does Christ have with Belial? What accord does Christ have with Belial? We must remember that this is written to the Corinthian church. And the Corinthian church was the church that gave Paul the most problems. They had been gleaned from the local area of Corinth, which was into all sorts of things, errors. And therefore, he writes this to them, saying, come ye out and be separate. In other words, as Christians, we are supposed to be separate from the world. And one of the points that he makes very early on in the scripture is, what accord does Christ have with Belial? Belial was a derogatory name, personal name, for the devil. It actually means utterly worthless. Regretfully, only the King James and New King James continue to use that word, I believe. It was also used as a name for false religions, which were considered to be inspired by Satan. There are various aspects of false religions which indicate that the cult is two things: either warped Christian or non-Christian. Most cults fall into one of these two things. Most cults. You have a warped Christian. Some Christians' confidence in the gospel is based on their experience of it. They maintain that it must be true because they experience inner peace, joy, and personal satisfaction from the gospel. Though their testimony may be true, this emotional response is not unique to Christianity. Devotees of other religions often say the same thing, and I'm thinking of the Moonies and the Krishnas and the Mormons. They all say the same. I have inner peace, I have joy and personal satisfaction with it. Therefore, we cannot say that they are Christian because they experience this. Love, joy, peace, patience, etc. are fruit of Christianity, but does not prove the veracity of the gospel. Real proof of the gospel is, number one, total satisfaction it gives, emotional, spiritual, moral, and physical. One of the things about Christians is they should be satisfied with whatever the Lord is bringing across their path right now. Do you understand? One of the great problems is we think that we should be over there or doing this or doing that. But the Lord knows. And the Lord is in charge. When you turn around and say, I want to give my heart to you, what you're saying is, Lord, take charge of my life. And he will do so. One of the most astounding things is he brings things across our path to drive us to one way and one way only, and that is to become Christ-like. To become Christ-like. The only way the Lord can do that is to bring incidents across our path that will drive us, will cause us to change. Many cults require their believers to depart from good sense and rational thought, even to the absurd. The gospel fits rationally into the whole of human experience. Confidence in the gospel is based on five things. Confidence in the gospel is based on five things. Number one, it's reasonableness. Come, let us reason together, saith the Lord. It's reasonable. If you weigh up and you go into the gospel, it's reasonable. The second thing, dear, I can't spell to save my life. My spell check is not working. authenticity of the Bible. Yeah. But not only that, it's the demonstrable authenticity of the Bible. When you think the Bible was written by how many authors?
40.
And there is a total of how many books?
66. The original authors didn't make some of them into two parts.
66.
All right.
Okay. 66 books. 39 in the Old Testament, 27 in the New. Written by 40 authors over a period of 1,500 years. Many of them never met other people that were writing. They were written in three languages from three different continents. But they all had one theme. It is astonishing. If you go in the UK and choose 40 authors, give them the sort of outline, I doubt very much if they will agree. That is absolutely phenomenal. The third thing we need to understand is the actions of God in history. We've been looking at that with the tabernacle, with the feast of the Lord on a Thursday, yeah?
Yeah.
So we can see the actions of God in history actually uphold the truth of the gospel. Don't worry, I'm trying to. I'm not going to use that pen. Right. Sorry. The fourth thing is the life and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Sir Robert Anderson wrote, by all the rules of evidence, the resurrection of Jesus Christ is beyond reasonable doubt. Beyond reasonable doubt. Praise God. And the fifth thing, quite astonishing, is the benefits it brings to its followers. There are many benefits. When I think of what my life was like before I became a Christian, I can honestly say I have benefited from becoming a Christian. But then there are thousands of people who would just say the same. Throughout history, history is littered with people whose life was changed. Look at John Wesley, Charles Wesley, Whitfield, and so on and so forth. You can go through them all. Okay, we're looking at warped Christianity. And so let's look at non-Christian. There are five major emphases that are common to cults and expose them as such. Five major emphases. Let's have a look at the first two, which is sort of slots into most of the cults. Pantheism, And the second one is transcendentalism. If it's spelt wrongly, it doesn't matter. Transcendentalism. It should be have a C in there. Pantheism. Pan, all, theo, God. And what it's basically saying is all is God. God is not personality, but the sum of all things, beings, forces, etc. Go to Glastonbury and you'll see this displayed. Transcendentalism says that God is so glorious and holy that he disdains to take notice of puny man. And I say most cults, many cults, fall into these two. However, there are others. You get asceticism.
So number three.
Asceticism, yes. I'm just making sure I've spelt it right, but don't worry about it. Extreme viewpoint that makes righteousness a matter of legalistic do's and don'ts. We find many cults turn around and say, you must do this, you must do that, you must do the other, and you mustn't do this, you mustn't do that, and so on and so forth. This is asceticism, where they are talking about a legalistic list of do's and don'ts that you must belong to. Believe it or not, there are many Christian denominations that fall into that way as well. Believe it or not. You get the fourth one is nihilism. Self-annihilation is the pathway to God. Self-annihilation is the pathway to discovery of God. But the gospel does not teach us that to find God we have to lose ourselves. Rather, we understand that as we enter into a relationship with God through Jesus Christ, we will find ourselves for the first time in our lives. Knowing God does not obscure knowing self, but ignorance is removed and I know myself as never before. Think about it. This is true. When I was in the world, I thought I was this and that and I was aiming here and aiming there. But since I have known the Lord, I understand that I am I'm seeking, what do you call it? I'm only interested in me. And that's something that the Lord has had to put right. Yeah? Remember? Many of you go back to the time that you were in the world, long time ago, I know that. But think about it. And the fifth one is a rationalism. bolstered by ritual, incantations, chants, repetitive prayers. Okay? They take place as a reasonable, they take the place of a reasonable view of life. But, as I said, the law says, or the Old Testament says, come, let us reason together. Yeah? There are certain other doctrines that and practices which identify as cult. The first one that we would think of is any religion that does not name the name of Christ as Lord and the only source of salvation must be a cult. Yeah? Any religion that does not name the name of Christ as Lord, only source of salvation, the only source of salvation, and the second one is any form of occultism, spiritism, necromancy, tarot cards, astrology, etc. Starting at the back, Maxine. Isaiah 8, 19 and 20, please. Isaiah 8, 19 and 20.
And they say to you, seek those who are mediums and wizards, who whisper and mutter. Shall not a people seek their God? Should they seek the dead on behalf of the living, to the law and to the testimony? If they do not speak according to this word, it is because there is no light in them.
Most famous scripture, Isaiah 8:20. If they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them.
Yeah.
Amen. Ross, Leviticus 19:31, please. Leviticus 19:31.
Are to mediums and familiar spirits, do not seek after them to be defiled by them. I am the Lord your God.
Rosie, you've got quite a chunk to read. Deuteronomy 18, 10 to 14. Deuteronomy 18, 10 to 14. Whenever someone would come and talk about divination or something like this, I would turn to this scripture, Deuteronomy 18, 10 to 14. Please read it, Rosie.
18, 10,
14.
Yeah. There shall not be found among you anyone who makes his son or his daughter pass through the fire, one who uses divination, one who practices witchcraft, or one who interprets omens, or a sorcerer, or one who casts a spell, or a medium, or a spiritualist, or one who calls up the dead. For whoever does these things is detestable to the Lord, and because of these detestable things, the Lord your God will drive them out before you. You shall be blameless before the Lord your God. For those nations which you shall dispossess, listen to those who practice witchcraft and to diviners, but as for you, the Lord your God has not allowed you to do so. The Lord your God will...
Okay, that's it. That is, together with Deuteronomy 13, there is a section there about the same thing. But you understand, it's very important. The Lord says, "You shall not be found. There shall not be found among you anyone that maketh his son or daughter pass through a fire." This was the problem why Israel could not inherit the promised land. Think about it. What did the Lord say? You cannot inherit the promised land because the sin of the Amorites is not yet full. Yeah? Who did the Amorites worship? Moloch. And they would worship Moloch by causing their children to pass through the fire. Yeah? Moloch was represented as a big idol, brass idol, which had a fire in its belly. And what the Amorites would do is put the child on his hands and the child would roll down into its belly. And they did that with the idea that they should become rich, because they were satisfying the God who supplied everything. And God said, "You shall not do it." Tell me seriously, why do a lot of women practice abortion today? Because they want to be better off. It's the same thing. Number three, cults which call themselves Christian deny some of the basic tenets of the gospel. Jehovah's Witnesses. Jesus, yeah, he's not God, alright? Or Mormons, Jesus and Satan are brothers, yeah? And number four, those who have a form of godliness, but who have entirely lost its power. Richard, 2 Timothy 3:5, please. 2 Timothy 3:5.
Denying the power thereof, from such turn away.
Okay. Now, we've completed that section. Any questions, anyone? Any points you want to raise?
I'll raise a quick one.
Yeah.
Would we be truly saying that one of the common things about cults is the control aspect, where often you're not allowed to leave, because if you did leave, you would be rejected and cut off from the family, as well as from the cult. Yeah. Is
that would be reasonable, because that sort of thing happens with the JWs, for instance. You are excommunicated, and you are told, your family is told not to contact you.
I think it's also that the Mormons do the same. I don't know about the Mormons, but they do that as well, I suspect.
I think they do. Yeah. I think they do.
You're right.
Separate in faith. And this bit is, do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. For what does a believer have in common with an unbeliever? Now, many people take this and stretch it out of proportion. So let's understand it. As we must be in contact with unbelievers, if we are to buy food, build houses, consult doctors, etc. Therefore, that can't mean that. Okay? I do not see that is the sense of this admonition. I do not believe that Christians and non-Christians should marry, but again, I don't see this scripture is necessarily concerned with marriage. We understand that a Christian shouldn't marry a non-Christian. If you become a Christian after marriage, and your spouse doesn't, when you have one prayer target, and that's given to you by the Lord, that you will pray for them daily until such time as they come to the Lord. The great problem is, if you have a Christian and a non-Christian, the Christian is heading for Christ. The non-Christian is heading away. Do you understand? So you'll never come together. If Christian and Christian, you're both heading towards Christ, when you come closer to Christ, you come closer to each other.
I was shown years ago, if you take that along the bottom, John, you've got the complete triangle.
Yep.
In counseling years ago, and it's good.
So, what do we think Paul is saying here? If you read in the context of his writing, we may have to be involved with the unbeliever in ordinary commercial alliances, community activities, public works. But we have nothing in common with them, and therefore we do not want to be yoked to their belief system. We may agree on commerce and industry, community activities, or social and artistic pastimes. We understand this. If a non-Christian writes a tune that you actually happen to enjoy, well, praise God. Because after all, he's only fulfilling what God said in the beginning. The fact that he's non-Christian doesn't matter. He's just being obedient to God, but he doesn't know it. Okay? When somebody builds a house, live in it, enjoy it. Praise God. The Lord is he may not know the Lord, but he's building the house, fulfilling God's command.
Exercising his God-given ability.
That's right. One of those things. But understand, we will never agree on our value system. They have a different yoke to us. Matthew 11:30, please, Sandra.
Matthew is easy, and my burden.
No, no. Person in the world.
No,
no person in the world can honestly say that. My yoke is easy, my burden is light. Because I must admit that when I was in the world, I thought the yoke was blooming hard. You understand? The Lord says, my yoke is easy, my burden is light. We're in the world, but not of it. And we must seek to retain our identity as supernatural children of God. When you think about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego walked into the flame without getting singed. We are to walk in this world, yet remain untouched by its attitudes and its ways. We must be separate in spirit and belief. Our confidence has a different base. Our lives have a different direction. Our joy has a different source. Our love has a different motive. Our security has a different defence. Our hope has a different guarantee. And I think that sums it up. Any questions?
Any, what you might call, I don't know, sort of active work in ministry. I found that when I was doing traveller work, and we kind of got mixed up with another organisation that was non-Christian, doing a similar work. We hired a room from them as a Christian sort of outreach thing for homeless people and travellers, and it never worked because they had a completely different basis for what they were doing.
Sure.
And there was always conflict and tension, and in the end we had to leave.
Yeah. Because there will always be a different thrust.
Yeah.
I can honestly say that one particular church in Quicklow turned around and said, we would like to receive donations because we want to feed the hungry. Mm. Well, no problem at all. So I said, yes, we'll give stuff, but it must never be promulgated what we give, and we stay completely Christian, and we hand out tracts with the food so people understand that we're Christian. We went away, came over to here actually, and went back, and we found that the local newspaper front page was a list of what people had given, including our church. And we'd given this and given that and so on and so forth. And then we discovered that the Buddhists had been roped in. And I said, well, what about the tracts? Well, you can't give tracts because they're Buddhists. But we're only looking for money to feed the poor. No, I'm not interested. That's it. And withdrew. You cannot have the same aim if you don't deal with a Christian. You're absolutely right, Alison. You run into trouble whenever you try. Father, we do ask, Lord, that you would help us to walk your walk, secure in the knowledge that we have a different belief system. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.